We are live, and our guest tonight is handwriting expert Kate Gladstone. Hi, Kate.
Hi, good to see you. Anyway, I'm really looking forward to tonight. We will be talking about archaeology and some of the very stunning recent discoveries. In fact, when I mentioned the first discovery and showed an article about it to one of my friends who is a handwriting book publisher and teacher, he said, you know, we're going to have to revise the next edition of our books because some of the volumes have a history of handwriting, and now they're going to have to add a whole new chapter, probably, I would imagine, or at least a new page before any of the previous pages. Well, I think that's wonderful. So we might as well start with that. If you ask anyone, you know, how old do they think writing was? You know, not necessarily this script or that alphabet, but how long has it been, you know, that people have, you know, had the idea that they could make marks on a piece of paper or clay or rock or whatever, and that those would be able to stand for things, words, sounds, what have you. And a lot of people say, I don't know, long time. You know, a lot of people might say, you know, a few thousand years, which is basically the archaeology answer, you know. But, you know, that's pretty well where the smart money was. But turns out that some of these symbols, which were part of cave paintings in Europe, which were representational art, but people always knew that there were little dots and lines and squigglies around some of the animals and things. Well, some amateur person, he was not, you know, a paleographer, namely a historian of writing. He was not an archaeologist. He was simply a guy with a knack for statistics. And we do have an article about this. He actually looked at some of these symbols. And if we have a close-up, you can see that they're marked in this photo from the Discover Science magazine. They weren't marked on the original walls, but they're marked here. So you can see that right alongside, you know, all these beautiful antelopes and, you know, what have you, all these lovely animals. There are dots, lines, little cross marks, all sorts of things. And, you know, no one really knew what they were, and people had all kinds of guesses. You know, were these like, was this like some kind of religious performance that you know, maybe people like dab their finger into paint on the wall for some kind of religious, you know, activity? And, you know, that's the archaeology cop out. If you don't know what something is, you say it's a religion. Well, anyway, it looks as if the numbers of the marks and some other features, such as their positions and arrangement, correlate very closely with things that primitive human beings, early human beings, would have wanted to record about the animals that they hunted, ate, and made almost everything they had from. Things like, you know, like lunar cycles in terms of mating cycles, in terms of when they, you know, procreated, when they had their babies, you know, when they went on migrations, where they went, and so on. And apparently this is, you know, if not, let's say, language as we know it, standing for words, it is at least numbers and some kind of numeric code. I like to think of this, look at this, I actually like to think of this as maybe the world's first, you know, ecology management spreadsheet. Okay. Because, I mean, but we don't know what all of it is. I actually, looking at this, I've wondered, since we don't know what all the symbols are, they might not all be numbers or calendar indications or anything. Wouldn't it be amazing if it turned out that some of these were the artist's signatures and those could be read?
That would be amazing. So let me ask you, Kate, and I'm going to just stop sharing that for a minute.
Yes.
And let me ask you, how did this amateur come about, conclusion?
Sometimes, I would say that sometimes it takes fresh eyes to see things. We all know of instances where kids have not been fooled by optical illusions that fool grownups. And we all know that sometimes it takes someone outside a particular field to notice someone who's really not inculcated into the orthodoxy. In other words, if you have been taught, let's say if you are a professional in ancient archaeology and you've studied ancient documents for, you know, your whole life, you might have you might have been taught ever since an early age what people believed and what they thought they had every reason to believe. Like, you know, we weren't advanced enough to have writing until, you know, a few thousand years ago when there were cities and farms and so on. You might not think to categorize a bunch of squigglies and dots as writing if it was where you thought the writing couldn't or shouldn't.
Yeah, okay. I'm not really asking how did he think of that, but how did he go about proving it to the establishment?
As I recall, and I did not really understand the explanation because I will be very honest that I am the sort of person who fell asleep a lot in math class. He he apparently did some statistical analysis. And now I'm not going to hide from you that I'm actually pulling up my article to refresh my memory of that, because that was rather complicated. Because remember, he was looking at hundreds and thousands of these all over Europe, all Asia, Africa. He was not, in other words, walking, you know, just looking at your random museum exhibit or some random, you know, cave. In other words, if you look at a lot of things you don't know what they are, and a lot of things you do know what they are, in other words, if you know animals and you know what the gestation period is, and if you see that the number of dots next to a certain animal just happens to be the number of lunar months it normally is pregnant.
Okay, Kate, where could we read the specifics? You know,
I did send you a link actually today from, well, you had originally shown me the Discover link to this item. And I sent you, I think I sent you.
Yeah, but I'm wondering, where is the scholarly article?
Well, you do have a link in the PowerPoint I made. Maybe you'd like to put that up, because we do have the links right there.
Okay. All right.
We do have it. I see now. It did not come out. I made a mistake. I should have sent you the font I used. Well, but we'll start with this. And because it came out blue, white on blue, which is not how I said it, you know, something is up with my settings. Okay, patterns of dots and lines. If you scroll down one of the slides after this one actually did have, I know I pasted, look at, that is not, those are the links for the second part that we didn't even get to.
Kate, I do have the link, and we have the article here.
Yes.
What I'm asking about is, you know, we do have the article here. But I was wondering, where is the scholarly article where he proved it?
Well, let's see. I did send you one that was, I think from Science News, and I could have sworn I put it in the PowerPoint. I'm very, very disturbed that's not there. If you give me a minute, just talk and cover me, because I'm going to look for.
Yeah, no, the reason I'm curious is because
writing 20,000 years ago, and this was indeed, we're talking 20,000 years ago. Okay, well, this has been reported, let's see, even though there was, well, one place was in.
Okay, you're talking about the Discover magazine?
Yeah, the Discover magazine article.
Yeah, I have it right here.
It did cite a couple of other more technical places that I was not able to get.
All right, I've got the Discover one up right now.
And I would say, you know, put this up. And we're saying, in other words, this is the Ice Age. In other words, these people did not have or use, as far as we know, any of the things that archaeologists think are the prerequisites to wanting to write.
Okay, I see.
Well, the archaeologists.
Cambridge Archaeology Journal.
Yeah, which I wasn't able to get to. I did try to get the link to the Cambridge Archaeology Journal. A lot of the links seemed to be down, and that one is behind a paywall in any case, even if you can get to it. So I'm afraid I had to content myself.
Okay, I think I got it.
Oh, you actually got it? Because I was not able to get it to come. Well, the abstract is there.
Okay, let's look at the abstract.
So we have someone who's literally doing the math, literally going through the numbers, seeing what signs occur most frequently and in what context.
Okay, I'm glad we have it.
And what's interesting is that even though now what's interesting to me actually is that even though these signs are very abstract looking, you know, lines, dots, some of them actually, it looks to me as if at least one of them could have originated pictorially. If you look at it, the team that looked at this established that a sign, which looks like a capital Y, was probably the sign for it gave birth. To me, when I look at something that looks like a capital Y, I think, well, a capital Y could very easily be interpreted as a stylized uterus and vagina, if you think about it.
Well, I think it's kind of interesting why, because the Hebrew word for birth is, it starts with a yod.
So. It does. Now, it would be amazing if we knew what language, you know, this was from. Of course, obviously, you know, the Hebrew letter equivalent to that, you know, that stands for that sound, doesn't look like it. It would be interesting, you know, I mean, since Hebrew is part of the Afro-Asiatic family of languages, and some of these finds were in, now, if you look at that elephant, that mammoth one, I want to mention that in a moment if you'll scroll down. That is actually a rather famous one and has been known for a while. But it's possible that people, some of the people in some of the regions, could have spoken a language that was related to or ancestral to Hebrew, given that Hebrew is part of a much bigger family of languages. And if you'll scroll down to H, which is the mammoth, there have been some people who've looked at that ovoid, sort of dented oval thing that's in the middle of the elephant's chest, the mammoth's chest, and have said, you know, that does look like a stylized heart, very much as we draw a heart today, which is not anatomically accurate, but does show that the heart is roughly pointy at the bottom and does have, you know, various lobes. So one of the speculations on that has been that this one, and this is a much older speculation, because I remember having seen this on a TV documentary when I was like 11, I don't remember which one, was that this may have been a hunting diagram for target practice to show you, in other words, here's the heart, aim at the heart, you know, let's throw some spears in, you know, see who gets the heart. So it may have been, there are people who do think that this is the first representation of a stylized pictorial heart, you know, the way that we draw it even today.
Which well, would be I'm wondering about that horse there. What is the horse doing by the elephant? I mean, what?
I would say, well, remember that in this era, horses were eaten. They were wild, and they were also a prey animal. You know, today in some countries, they do still eat horse meat. In fact, did you know the Harvard Club even used to serve horse meat once a week? Did you know that?
No, I didn't.
They actually
but I know dog food. I know dog food is made of it.
They couldn't get what else they like, but people actually developed a taste for it. And if you go to Russia, you know, today if we hear about someone eating horse meat, we think, oh, this is gross. They're reduced to eating, you know, dog food out of the cans, or they like, who would eat a horse? But in Russia, it's like considered this real, real delicacy, to the point that in Russian, you know, just as in English, when there are meats that are very prestige meats, we don't call them by the same name as the animal for various historical reasons. If you eat something from a cow, it's beef. And if you eat something from a pig, it's pork. Well, horse in Russian is loshad. But if you eat it, if it's, you know, a horse steak that you're getting, assuming you're lucky enough to get that, it has another name, konina, which actually comes from a literary word for horse, kon, which is like a steed. In other words, you know, the horse runs in the field, but when you kill it, it's meat from a steed. It's, you know, better or fancier or prestige or aristocratic. Yeah. I wouldn't be surprised if a society that, you know, hunted and ate horses thought of it as a very valuable type of meat, because I have never eaten horse meat. I have actually seen it in fancy butcher shops that in like ethnic neighborhoods, but I've never eaten it. And the place I saw we're in, we're not even in this country, but it is very dark and it's very rich looking. And, you know, people have eaten it, tell me that it is, you know, very rich tasting and very soft. You know, let's just say that if there are horses, and if you haven't yet invented anything that requires a horse to pull your cart, and if you haven't yet figured out how to ride one, you know, one of the more obvious things to do would be to eat it. And since horses at the time, if we assume they were still wild, they probably were. If your tribe is following around the horses, you want to kill them at the right moment. Here we have This has been speculated to be a pregnant horse, actually. Someone killing a pregnant horse because they want, you know, they were going to eat fetus horse. Which, if this sounds disgusting, there are actually cultures where people do eat fetal animals because they are naturally, you know, very, very tender, you know, even more tender than baby animals. So, but of course, if you're going to go around killing pregnant horses for a delicacy, you don't want to kill all of them because you want to have more horses. So, of course, you know, I don't know if that thing on the bottom.
Well, I mean, did they have to kill the mother or did they get somehow to the fetus without killing?
Well, them? I do not know if they had invented horse abortions back then. I wouldn't be surprised if they had. But again, I wouldn't be surprised if before whatever point they might have had some herbal thing they could give the horse or whatever. At some point, if they'd wanted it, they would have had to kill the horse. And what's very interesting is what I find interesting in this is not so much a writing thing, but I don't know if you know what that is. I wonder if the thing in the back, though, is the baby's leg sticking out. I don't know. I don't know what it is. This could be, you know, but again, I am neither a veterinarian nor, you know, a gynecologist.
Well, it looks like one leg is inside and the other.
Yeah,
it,
so it could be sort of an attempt at drawing the fact that there is
a breech birth, though.
Yeah, now what's really interesting to me is if you look at the hooves, you see that they don't, it doesn't look like the bare normal hoof of an animal, but it doesn't look like horseshoes either. It looks like the horse is wearing socks, doesn't it? Tied on socks.
Mittens,
you could say. Well, I'm thinking of socks because there are actually things you can buy called horse socks that have been put on horses in environments where they needed, you know, to have quiet for some reasons. I've heard of them being used sometimes when horses are getting ready for a horse show. They're not at the actual show. I've heard of them being used by veterinarians that work with farm animals if a horse's hooves have been damaged either by horseshoes or by very rough terrain and it needs some time to recover, so it needs a cushioned sock. And to me, it's likely, it's at least possible if you have a herd of horses and you want them not to run away, you might see if you could get some socks on your horses because it might be harder for them to run away if they're in this big, puffy-looking sock. But again, I don't know. Maybe someone who's watching this is a horse expert.
My point about if those are the hooves of the baby, you know, the fetus.
They might be.
Well, then it's a breech birth, which is not a good way to go.
Not a good birth. And all I can say is trying to put myself in the mindset of someone who's raising horses to eat, if that's what they were doing, which I would presume. Well, if you know that the horse is having a problem, you might want to kill the mother, eat the mother, kill the baby, eat the baby, because if this is a mother that's prone to have breech births, maybe you don't want her in your herd, so you might as well eat her, as well as...
Wait, we have a question from one of our viewers. Would you like to read that?
Do they represent both male and female genitals? I would say, well, let's just say I have seen a male horse's genital. I don't see anything that really looks like this. I've never been that close to a female horse, and the only two times I saw a male horse's genital was on a policeman's horse. Sometimes, you know, policemen.
I'm asking about your experience.
If we don't see the genitals, it might mean that these are all mares. It might mean they're all female. I don't know. I don't know if that, you know, I'm hoping that someone who watches this now, but when we see on top of these horses, we see still signs, you know, and people have thought, earlier people have thought, one, oh, it's a religious thing. We don't have to explain it. Some of them have thought that these were stylized spears showing someone killing the animal, but that's unlikely because we can see real spears realistically drawn in some of the same photos. Not this one, but some of them. In other words, why? Why would someone who could draw a real spear, you know, draw a really lousy spear? So maybe it's not a spear. In other words, here we have what is apparently the head of some animal, and we have, you know, marks on 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. You know, I do not know what this meant. That part might be either genitals or the one in picture F might be genitals or a stylized picture of the horse's rear end, which I'm sure if they were drawing, I would not think that they had the sort of slang we had today, but we don't know, you know. I do have a feeling they were more likely illustrating the anatomy of the horse than saying that so-and-so is, you know.
Yeah, but, no, I'm trying to figure out the writing thing. I'm not that.
I would say, now, I will tell you that I was not totally surprised when I read this news about some kind of symbolic representation of concepts, you know, for writing 20,000 years ago. I was not surprised because for quite a long time, get this, the archaeologists have known that it's very common in certain parts of, you know, in certain places where they're Paleolithic, old Stone Age sites, to dig up things like horns or other crescent-shaped objects such as carved wood, which are marked with series of markings. And the markings are very, very often an average of 28, you know, maybe give or take one. Now, some people had thought that this was astronomy, a lunar calendar, marking, in other words, having a group of like 28 marks and then one big one to mark when the new moon was or the full moon was. But the fact that it wasn't always 28 would appear to argue that the science involved was not astronomy, but gynecology, if you get my drift.
I get it.
In other words, you know, not to put too fine a point on it, but let's just say that there are reasons to keep a calendar, that women may certainly have a reason. Well, in fact,
the thing is that women's cycles went by the moon.
Exactly, yeah. And again, I'm not trying to be too graphic. I don't know if people have their kids around or what, you know. It's late.
Right. Nothing graphic. I'm just saying there's not really a big difference because when people were sleeping out and moon affected everything.
Yeah, and it does certainly. I mean, they tell you even today, if you want to regularize your cycle, find out what day is the full moon and leave the light on in your bedroom that day and the day before and after. And it apparently works. But, you know, but not everyone is necessarily clockwork regular. You know, they would find one that was 27 or one that was 29 or something. So obviously it wouldn't have been counting the moon in the sky unless whoever was doing it was bad at math. Plus, for what it's worth, one of these items, these calendar type of things that was found, was actually not an object, but was a depiction of one, namely a horn-shaped object with 28 marks on it, which was drawn on some wool in the hand of a woman, apparently running or dancing. Okay? So I would say, so obviously whoever was making these did think of them as connected with women. I would assume that if we could find who invented timekeeping, we might very well find that it was a woman, as they would simply have more reason to keep track of, you know, certain recurring types of things. And they might be able to see, as you mentioned, you know, a correlation with, you know, the moon and so on. And of course, that would, of course, explain why someone would decide to have a Y-shape, whatever that might represent, in their system. So if you look at the left column of the page, you'll see one of the speculations had been that they were just stylized outlines of blood or breath, the way that you might draw dotted lines to indicate someone breathing out in a cartoon. But why, in that case, would certain things be consistently marked with certain numbers? Why would aurochs, in other words, wild cows, wild bulls, and fish, and a species of cicada type of insect, all be marked with a 4? And he draws some conclusion from this. In other words, you know, did something happen to them every 4 years or in the fourth month of whatever year? He believes that this was, you know, a calendar with months. So I think that, you know, if you have this, you know, if this had been found in any later era, people would unquestionably say this is writing, someone of a sort. Someone is keeping tabs on something. Someone is, you know, even if it's some very simple system of dots or lines or what have you.
Okay, even, and over here they're talking about how they tested the hypothesis.
Exactly, which you have to test. I mean, and people forget that it's not enough to have a hypothesis. You have to try to shoot down your own hypothesis.
Right.
And they believe that, you know, they're testing, in other words, they really, if you look at this, they really are trying to explode this. And they're looking at, you know, what seasons things were plentiful. And they concluded that they were counting from the start of a particular season, the bon saison, it was the good season. It was, you know, the season when things were plentiful, and that's when their calendar started. You know, no one says a calendar has to start on January, you know, 1st. Most calendars historically have started because of some seasonal event that could be observed, or, you know, or something that could be easily seen in the sky or on the earth. Now, here's how he actually tabulated, in other words, sequences. In other words, he basically tabulated the sequences and came up with whatever conclusion that these associated with, you know, is that these showed a pattern that's correlated with when these animals give birth, mate, migrate, and so on. So I have to say that, you know, whoever did this, you know, was obviously had a lot in mind. Obviously, it was not just some random, you know, random, just, you know, let's put pictures on the walls and, you know, see what we can put next to the pictures. Now, wouldn't it be incredible if we could actually, calculate their whole calendar? We might even be able to find or speculate what else they did that was governed by their calendar. In most cultures, there are holidays that happen on certain dates at certain times. So why this is interesting is it would give archaeologists a lead for what to look for. In other words, just to take a very simple example, if you have a civilization, you know, before there are, you know, interstate shipments and refrigerated train cars and so on, certain foods will only exist at certain times of the year. If you're looking at anything in prehistory or even in history before the Industrial Revolution, and if you see that, if you dig up something and it looks like the remains of a feast and there were a lot of cherry pits all over the place, you not only conclude, okay, they like cherries, they were eating cherries, or at least at this occasion they were, you would be able to conclude that it would have happened in June or July if it looked like these were remains of fresh cherry pits, because that's when you get the cherries. So what's interesting is that these are not only clues on what people might have thought were worth writing down, but they might be clues as to what else to look for. In other words, if it should turn out that since the horses were giving birth early in June and July, it might turn out that maybe if you found a lot of horse bones and you found other things that were indicative of a certain season, that would actually be another way to check if your calendar deduction that this was their calendar was right or was wrong. Mm-hmm. So in other words, if you were an archaeologist, the fact that this might be writing would give you an immense way to test many other fields. And it's I would say that this is interesting. We have a lot to cover. It does get a lot into the statistical analysis. I suspect that I'm not the only person here whose head starts to spin when you get too much into the math and the graphs and so on. I would say that he's proven his point, but I would say that that is subject to my own mixed level of knowledge and ignorance, mostly the latter. You know, after all, I have never, you know, worked on a farm or, you know, herded animals or any of that. You know, I would not be able to test this, but I would say look for it, because I would say, what I'm thinking is if they had some system of writing of some sort that was used for things like numbers and a calendar, well, maybe they used it for other things. After all, other civilizations like the Sumerians that started with numbers and a calendar as basically what they wrote down, they didn't stop there. They went on and they did other things. Perhaps there are other things, descendants or developments of this waiting to be found somewhere that we just haven't found or just haven't looked. Okay. I would also point out that if you are looking at 20,000 years ago, you're looking at a time when there were not only humans who look like us, anatomically modern, but there would have been the Neanderthal variety. I do not know if any of these caves had Neanderthals, but given the time period, it could have happened. Someone should be checking into this, because if they could find that Neanderthals had writing, suddenly science fiction would come alive. Suddenly the world of archaeology would.
Oh, I would. I would not be surprised at all. I think the Neanderthals were quite capable of it. We do have another observation or question by.
Yes, let's go down because I can't see it. Reeves a horse. They may not have bothered drawing the exact word symbol out. Yeah. I mean, would they actually have seen it? Well, that's a good point that they wouldn't, because female reproductive organs are normally just not as in your face. Okay. But I would say that they could have seen it and not bothered to, you know.
Well, I mean, if they actually harvested unborn horses. Yeah.
They would have had to.
Right. In other words, exactly.
I mean, they would have had to at some point, whether or not they drew it. I mean, frankly, it's harder to draw the female reproductive organs than the others because it's less easily visible. I would say that they had to have seen it. I would say that if you look at any society that farms animals or that herds animals, and back then we're presuming it would have been herding. We haven't yet found farming from that period. I don't really think we will. You know, most of them have a way to pregnancy check the animal if it's pregnant. And that way, of course, is not ultrasound. It's not what the hospital would use on you today. It's not what the farm would have. They had to do I'm not going to describe pregnancy checking for animals, except that you do have to get down and dirty and it's not pretty. And let's just say it's gross. And I saw it in a documentary and it's gross, but you definitely would have been, if you were managing, not only following this herd, but perhaps managing it, which the fact that they're keeping literally tabs, they're keeping numerical data suggests they were doing, you probably would have wanted to check how the animal's pregnancy was going if it wasn't one that you were just chasing after. If these were not necessarily animals that were always being hunted, they may have been herded, because remember, these people could build structures. People have found stone circles, and I don't always mean like Stonehenge and monuments, sometimes low walls built of stones without gaps, which very obviously could be a pen for animals. We don't know. One of the problems is that most of the things human beings do don't fossilize well. You know, dancing doesn't fossilize well. Talking doesn't fossilize well. Even something like braiding a bridle and bit for a horse, if you're just starting to learn about riding one, if it's made out of straw, that may not fossilize very well either. And, you know, there's so much that we don't know and we won't know. You know, we don't know what their languages were like. It's too far back for us to even reconstruct a lot. But imagine if it turns out that they had a way of recording their language. We would suddenly know a lot more about them than we know now. And we literally now know more about them than we knew literally a month ago, because this thing came out about a month ago, this discovery. Right?
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
So
let me remove that. Do you want to go back to the PowerPoint?
Yeah. I will tell you, next time I'm going to do my PowerPoint and not do the fonts as fonts. I'll do them as graphics, because I'm really disgusted with myself how this show did not really show up. You know, I will tell you a secret. If you want to see what's on the screen, and it came out this white on baby blue, which is not what I did, you know, what you can do is if you take a snapshot, a screenshot of whatever you want, put it in your camera and use the filters to darken it and increase the contrast, it will be legible. Now, going to something much more recent, this is only 3,000 years old, and crazy if that sounds, only is perfectly a reasonable adjective given that we've just been talking about 20,000 years. This is 3 millennia years old. This may be the earliest biblical, non-biblical mention of King David. You know, King David is a very prominent person in the Bible, and people have wondered, you know, was he real? Were these just stories? Were they exaggerated? Was he made up and legendary, you know, or can we believe that there was such a person, even, you know, even if we don't know everything about him that we might like to? Well, this happens to be, as those of you who are familiar with Paleo-Hebrew writing, the ancient Paleo-Hebrew equivalent of the letters that in modern Hebrew would be Dalet, Vav, Dalet, which spells David, as in David. His name, in other words, occurred. And now one article of many where this was reported was basically new decipherments of slang that we've had for years. The Mesha Stele, or aka the Tel Don Stele, people have gotten much better pictures of its of the writing on it, which was very worn out and very weathered. And we actually use, you know, computer enhancement, basically the same sort of thing I just told you to do with your phones to get a clearer picture. And some of the letters that we weren't sure of, we can actually read, and people can actually read this. And this is actually an inscription that was done in the name of, well, our PowerPoint said, did King David write this? Well, probably another king wrote this one, but may have mentioned David, the king of Moab, King Mesha of Moab. And those of you who are Bible readers, you know about Moab as a kingdom in ancient times that was next to Israel, that, you know, there were dealings between Israel and Moab, but more often there were wars. But there were other sorts of dealings. After all, according to the Bible, King David's great-grandmother came from the country of Moab. She was Ruth, for those of you who read the Bible.
Yes.
And anyway, we have an inscription which basically tells about a war, a battle that's known in the Bible, tells about it, you know, from the other side, the enemy's side, and is mentioning King David and the house of David. In other words, this is not something that you would be able to say, oh, this is just a legend, you know. This is something where you have a person from that period of history writing about a country, writing it, you know, mentioning its head of state. In other words, it, you know, has to be real if this is, you know, if it was from the country, if it was from David's own country, you might say it was made up to sort of promote him. But if it's from his enemy country, you know, you have to presume it's real. But people were in doubt over whether the letters that spell out David in this example really spelled out David, because they were sort of old, worn, broken. You know, think of how something you write is going to look 3,000 years from now.
Well, I mean, anytime you see David written, it also is that there's a possibility
it could
that
it would
dod.
Which is the word for uncle, and in biblical times is also the word for beloved. It could be, but in this context, it does not necessarily make sense. If it's being used as someone's name, it might actually be. I know one of the things about Hebrew, like it or not, is that because the vowels aren't written and some of the other letters have changed from vowels to consonants or vice versa over time, you know, David and Dod literally are spelled the same. And in earlier times, back when all the V in Hebrew, back when the V sound was still W, they would have sounded even closer. David and Do. They would have sounded that close.
David.
Yeah. Now, what's very interesting, and you probably know this, Julia, and you probably know this, Aya, but not a lot of people do, is there's some speculation that David might not even have been the name he was born with, much as other people in ancient Hebrew culture and other cultures have changed their names or been given different names or been given titles or new names when they became a king or something. Well, what's interesting is that, well, we all know in the Bible, it says that David killed Goliath. Now, what's interesting is that in another book of the Bible, somewhere in Chronicles, it talks about a man named Elkanah, and depending on which Bible translation you read and which manuscript they're based on, it either says he killed Goliath's brother or he says he killed Goliath. For those who know Hebrew, such as Julia and Aya, you have, you know, if he killed Goliath, that would be et Goliath, would mean, you know, Goliath. If he killed Goliath's brother, that would be ach Goliath. But et and ach, the first letter are the same, and the second letter is almost the same, only one little bitty twiddle of the pen. Now, admittedly, in Paleo Hebrew, those two letters did look way different, but people have wondered if there could have been a copying mistake in modern times, and if so, if the guy who killed Goliath was actually named Elkanah, maybe that was David's name, and he got the name Beloved, David, when he became king, because kings want flattering titles. And, you know, frankly, it looks like a lot of people did love him. And
yeah, he was a lover.
Well, let's just say he was. Yeah. Okay. let's just say He loved a lot of people and a lot of people loved him. Okay.
Okay.
So people have speculated that it could be a nickname because we know that very, very often in ancient Hebrew culture, if something significant happened to you, you would change your name or other people might change your name for you. The most famous example, of course, is Jacob. Yaakov ended up being called Yisrael. Jacob became known as Israel after a very, you know, very significant experience in his life. We know of, you know, similarly with Abraham, but he'd started life as Avram. The woman he married was Sarai. And at some point, according to the Bible, God literally told them to change their names, you know, told, you know, Avram, your name shall be Avraham, and Sarai, your name shall be Sarah, because names have meanings. Many names in Hebrew are words or even phrases or whole sentences. And those names had a slightly different meaning from their original name. So that's, you know, part of the story, or even less famous.
Oh, Kate, do we have a transcription of everything that's on the stele?
It's probably, well, there is, I think there probably is one on Wikipedia. If you go to Wikipedia and put in Mesha Stone, they have an excellent article. The last time I checked, it did have a transcription. And if you can't find this, all over the net. If you put in Mesha, M-E-S-H-A, that's M as in monkey, E as in egg, S is in string, H is in hello, A is in apple, and you put in Mesha Stone or Mesha Stele, S-T-E-L-E. There we go. If you put that in, there is, if you scroll down, it's a little hard to see there, but there is actually, well, we actually have a picture of it, which I think they did in one of those Unicode fonts you can get. I don't know if they don't have the transcription up, knowing them, they'll have a, yeah, if they, they, oh yeah, they do have, you scroll down, they still have it up there. Yeah. Well, they have at least a translating parts of it, which is very cool. If you read it, it does have the literary style of the Bible, even though it's not the Bible, because it was being written in the same part of the world in a rather similar culture. If you read this aloud to someone who didn't know the Bible very well, they would think you were reading to them from the Bible. If you want to read it, basically, you know, he's taught, it's basically an announcement, you know, he fought a war, he won the war, he killed this city, and he, you know, looted that city, and he did the other city, and he's talking about, you know, basically, it's the usual, you know, governmental combination of reportage and look how awesome your leader is. Mm-hmm. Okay. And that hasn't changed, but perhaps our way of expressing it has changed. And if you go up, there is actually, so you actually see a translation, and, you know, some of the people who are mentioned, for instance, and Omri, king of Israel, is mentioned at some point. In other words, if you're a Bible reader, you'll be picking up that some of this is familiar, but it's the opposing viewpoint. It's told from the viewpoint of the culture that did not survive versus the one or a one that did.
Okay, so where's the mention of David?
I have not been able to find it. Probably not in the part there. Copying, not in the part they're copying here. Look, it's obviously not copying the whole thing.
Okay. And all right.
This transcription might still be the one that was made sort of by guesswork before they really cleaned off the stone. They might have been guessing which one. The word that we now think is David, they thought was another name, Balak, okay, which is
let's look at the word to the right of David over here.
Let's go.
It's an Aleph, a Resh, yes, an Aleph. And what letter is this?
I don't know it. That one, that is actually Lamed, believe it or not. It does look like a cursive Hebrew tet, but it is a Lamed from everything I've seen. Okay.
So it's Al-El.
Yeah. Which could make some kind of sense.
Okay.
And I would leave it to you to recognize it. One of the cool things about, you know, things that survive from the Moabites, and there are not many of them, is that the language was really close to Hebrew. I was actually told by my archaeology professor that if you ever found anything from the Moabites and something from the ancient Israelites and you read them, you probably would be 2/3 of the way through the document before you knew which culture had done which inscription.
They were mutually intelligible.
Yeah, I mean, in fact, it's estimated that these were actually closer to each other than British English and American English. And, you know, mm-hmm. you can pick up a book from England and you don't know it's a book from England until a word is spelled the way you didn't learn how to spell it, you know, and you could be halfway through the book before that happened. Mm-hmm. One thing that scientists found with the Moabites is sometimes they left out some of the letters that became silent in later Hebrew, like Aleph or Ayin. That sometimes happens, so speculation that those might have begun to be silent for them too. But we don't find that in all of the writings, just sort of occasionally, you know, basically maybe a spelling error. And we have, why do Phoenician and Hebrew sound similar? Excellent question, because they're practically the same. Mm-hmm. For those who never realized that the Phoenicians and the Canaanites were the same people, they were.
Yes.
And, you know, the early, you know, if the Bible is right about the early ancestors of the Hebrew coming from way out east, from, you know, Babylonia, from, or, you know, they would not have spoken the Hebrew language then, and they would have acquired it when they got there, when they moved in, so to speak, with their new neighbors. Now, what's very, very interesting, if you, at some point, some people may have seen the current Hebrew alphabet. They may have, you know, and this is way different.
It's the Assyrian one, but they are actually.
It would actually be possible for some, you know, people have actually done charts tracing the evolution. In fact, I'm trying to see if I can get. Do you know if StreamYard includes a whiteboard? We used to use Zoom, which included.
Yeah, Zoom has a whiteboard.
StreamYard does not. I'm going to pop out and check because they're always adding new things, you know? I want to just check.
Okay. Well.
Because if they added one, great. If not.
I just don't see that
possibility. I don't see it myself. I'm just. Online whiteboard. I don't do devices that. No, apparently there's something special you can buy, but you know, as to actual having it built in, you know, I was hoping that we'd have it, but
maybe you could show your iPad or something like that.
I'm on my iPad, and here's what I'm going to do. There should be a way to reverse the camera so I can have it photograph on a piece of paper, because I have some paper and I was going to write something about something that turned off the camera, but I wish to reverse the camera and I can't find a way to do that. Most of these apps have some way.
It says picture in picture layout.
I'm trying to find this, you know, I'm literally, you know, talking to Google because I had wanted to go and show a little live.
Yeah, I want you to be able to.
Okay. Apparently, let's see, you can mirror, how to use an extra camera. Share extra camera. Apparently you can, apparently there's some way to do the equivalent. You're supposed to go to where it says share and click on extra camera, but I can't find anything that says share. Apparently, if I go to share and I click something called extra camera up more, let's see, settings, comments. I feel like an idiot. Okay, camera. Well, right, good old back camera. I have some paper here and I'm going to do something fun. Okay, and today, in honor of the ancient Phoenicians, I decided to use a purple marker, because the Phoenicians were known for their purple, and because the name Phoenician is actually derived from the Greek for purple, because that was the land the purple dye came from. Now, one thing that used to puzzle me when I was a little kid, and I was very interested in archaeology, and I actually knew about Paleo-Hebrew. In fact, for a time, I actually kept a diary of English transcribed into Paleo-Hebrew letters with a few things I'd made up for sounds that, you know, Hebrew doesn't use, but English does. And I always wondered, how is it that in modern Hebrew, we know that, oh, why is this marker? Yeah, there we go. In modern Hebrew, the samech is a circle. If it's a little more classy, one might look a little like this, but it's a circle, right? Or approximately a circle.
Well, but it looks like a half pita. This is only in handwriting, but in printing, it looks like a half pita.
And like this, right? More like that. Yeah. You know, I'm not good. I will tell you, I was okay with Hebrew cursive, although I do prefer basically Hebrew printing, which no one uses except Hebrew first Israeli first graders and professional scribes. Okay. But how would you say, if these, a circle or some kind of, you know, triangle thing, but anyway, enclosed, how would this be a samech now when we knew that 3,000 years ago when King David was alive and, you know, 3,500 years ago when Moses was alive, this was, I'm trying to get more ink, this was a samech. And for those who need to know, let's see, this was, I mean, these are so opposite that if someone asks you to make two shapes that were the most opposite in the world, that's probably what you would come up with. You know, how does a circle end up being a thing that looks like, come from a thing that looks like a barbecue grill? Now, nobody told me, nobody knew. It's like, well, this happened. Nobody really knew. I think people knew, but my teachers didn't happen to know because most people don't know. Well, that would have been a mystery to anyone except that when handwriting, Hebrew handwriting from a very from transitional periods, for instance, from, you know, Alexandrian Egypt, where there was a Jewish garrison for many years and documents were dug up there. Documents were dug up sometime in late Babylonia where there were Jewish enclaves. Well, we saw that in early you'd have this, and that was the samech, which, by the way, for those who know Greek, gave rise to the Greek C. They just left out the middle part. For those who don't know Hebrew, this is that sound. Okay. And it's, so what happened? Okay, if you're writing this, let's go. And let's say you're writing this, and let's say you're pretty fast. You know, you might go and, you know, leave out a couple of strokes like this. What's going to happen if you're fast? You're probably going to take a shortcut instead of, well, you know, I go left, right, left, right. You just, you know, that's enough. Oh, I got to put this. And before you know it, you have this. It's a two-stroke samech. And then, of course, the modern handwritten one is a one-stroke one, making life super confusing if any of the ancient Hebrews like David or Solomon or Moses before were to come back, because back then in that day, believe it or not, that circle was an ayin. And to, you know, in other words, the same shape standing for different sounds, which confusingly are next to each other in the Hebrew alphabet. And so if you wanted to wonder, well, how, if that was the ayin so many years ago, how did it get to be this? You know, in other words, if that was, let's go here. If that circle thing was an ayin 3,000 years ago, and then the printed one is like this, and then the modern cursive one, there have been various Hebrew cursives, is like this. How did that even happen? It almost looks like you're returning in history to the original circle shape, but not quite. Okay, you have a circle. When you are writing with something like an edged pen on rough paper, you're tempted to break up circular strokes, and you're tempted to not, because it's hard to sort of go down and up. You're going to be very more willing to go down and do it in two strokes. You're going, and once you do that, if you are used to it, if you want it to be a square pattern so it fits better into the margins, it's easier to learn, easier to measure, or maybe even just looks a little more like the cuneiform of all your Babylonian neighbors. If I have a hard time writing, it's because I'm balancing this thing. You'll end up with this. And of course, what happens when you end up with this? If you're writing this, and if you're actually writing in Hebrew rapidly, and if this is what you know, if that's your ayin, you have to write it because it's in a lot of quite common words, you're going to be tempted to take a shortcut. You're like, oh, go up, you know? And once you do this, and there actually are medieval Hebrew cursives where it's more like this, but eventually you do have this. And all these things happen and people don't know it. Much as when we learn English, you know, we learn to read and write English and someone says, well, here's a capital E and here's a lowercase e and they're totally not related, just memorize it. Or here's a, you know, printed capital G and here's a cursive capital G and just memorize it. You know, if I thought there was any demand, I actually would probably write a book called Capitals to Lowercase Fast. But the point is the history exists. And I would have benefited a lot when I was a kid learning Hebrew, since they showed us some of the archaeology stuff even way back then. You know, it would have been good if someone had explained this. Now, for some of them, it's very obvious that you just have a change in tools, a change in pens and things speeding up. And I like to imagine that if you have a Paleo-Hebrew Aleph, with Aleph, because I'm picking for your name, Ayah, okay, and if this was it, you have this, and yes, I am going right to left, but not so much. You have this. It may be obvious that you could actually get from this to our familiar Roman capital. Not so, and they actually did it that way, left, middle, right, which is super efficient. If you do it that way, try it. And once you have this, you can have, if you speed it up, you're going to be half of the way to lowercase. And incidentally, you're going to be, now I'm just finding I can't really write like this. I'm going to, new sheet of paper, guys. Let's hope the second time is lucky. In other words, if this was your Aleph, and if this was your Alpha, and then this could be your A, Roman cell A, you can go, you end up with this, you end up with this, you're going to end up with this, and you're even going to end up from this basis, if you want to make it a little less like a D, a little less confusable, you'll have the, what I call the typewriter A, although it's much older. People think of it.
Kate, so the, you know, the square letters that we have for Hebrew today, they came from the Assyrian writing system, which they borrowed from the Phoenician. So how did we get the Aleph that we have now?
That's very interesting. Let's go back to our, you know, primordial Phoenician one. And I was hoping you'd ask that question. I knew you'd be the one to ask it. I'm going to try to go right to left, which is the way Hebrew goes, of course, just because you're an Israeli originally, and this will be, it won't be comfortable for me, but let's try to do things correctly for a change. I'm trying to get, why can't I get my pen in the picture? It's because this is bloody awkward. That's one thing they didn't have to contend with. Come on, guys. Come on. Why can't I get my, I feel like a vampire. So if this is your Aleph, now you can have something like this. And you can have, in other words, this diagonal, this top diagonal became this thing. But you did tend to have, typically they're like this, because if you look at this, this is what we ended up with. But if you think of it, it's the movement pattern. I like to say letter is not a shape, but a path. You can still see this part is the part that was the Aleph, and this is the stroke that came down. And of course, if you look at the cursive Aleph, which has been done differently in different parts of the Hebrew and Yiddish speaking world, some of them look like, you know, some of them look like this. This is not standard, but you just some of them look like this, which is almost looks like a K, but it's almost like going back to the original.
Yeah.
And some of them, the one I learned in school, look like this. And for some reason, you were not supposed to make them touch, but one of my teachers did, of course, make them touch. Well, everyone has. And if you think of it, if this is what you know as Aleph, and if you're writing it, their ductus, in other words, their pen path, their order of strokes was probably this way, which is not the way that most letterers would do it today, but it seems to have been their way. There is actually a wonderful book, which is about $60, but go and buy it in English or Hebrew. It was printed twice in both languages. It's called A Book of Scripts. It is by a lovely Israeli scholar. I think she's dead now, but she's called Ada Yardeni. And I'll spell this in English because I know you can spell it for yourself in Hebrew. For those looking it up, A Book of Hebrew Scripts. Correcting, that's the name. A Book of Hebrew Scripts by Ada, A-D-A Yardeni, Y-A-R-D-E-N-I. As far as I know, it's not in Kindle. You'll have to buy the whole thing. It's gigantic. It's like a coffee table book on steroids, but it's beautiful. You know, I actually had one and, you know, a student actually stole it years ago and I was not able to track him down, but I could see being tempted. I did eventually buy another one. It's a huge book, but you will see writing from every period of Hebrew history, including all these intermediate transitional forms. There are actually writings from some rather famous people, not only some people who were prominent. I've got a little Velcro here to keep my camera on. That's why that thing that you keep see showing up, you know, it's just sticking something on my camera so that, you know, I have something glued on it. I don't want to fall off, you know, a little battery charger, you know. So you'll see writing from basically Hebrews who were prominent in the Roman empire. So if you want to see, you know, what politicians wrote thousands of years ago, you can. You will see writing from, there's a figure who's very famous in the history of Israel, not so well known in America, but Bar Kokhba. You will actually see Bar Kokhba's actual handwriting on his military dispatches. Pretty different from any model you will have seen now. But, you know, there have been a lot of models. In fact, if you look at the cursive that the Sephardic Jews, the ones who descended from the Escapes of the Spanish Inquisition, used for Hebrew, that looks like the Hebrew cursive you and I grew up by, but the actual letter assignments are different. The one that looks like a mem is an aleph, for instance. And there's one, look it up, is called Solutreo. If you look at it, it's mind-boggling. You say, this looks like Hebrew cursive. I should understand this, but I don't. It looks like totally bonkers. But you can get the code to it. You know, you can get, so to speak, the decoder ring to it. And there are people who still learn to write it as part of their culture, you know, of that particular subset of Judaism. By the way, one of the most amusing things about Bar Kokhba's letter, if you get the book and read it, is that it's in a very colloquial Hebrew. Hebrew was still spoken, and it's so colloquial that instead of saying things like et hamakom, he's saying tamakom.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, slang. It's like everyone thinks this is like recent slang today, but it already isn't, and very predictable. Not to digress too much for those who don't know Hebrew, but we know that in Hebrew, you know, asher became sheh at some point, and el became lo. You could say el hamakom, but we more often say lamakom. El hamakom is sort of literary and biblical. And they were simply doing the same thing by analogy. If el can become le, then et can become ta. Very, very obvious. So if you see it, it's obviously, this is not literary Hebrew. You know, this is someone, you know, scribbling a military dispatch to his scouts. He's not sitting around trying to pick the right flowery phrase of language, even though he probably had a taste for history. Because even though the Hebrew was already the square Assyrian-influenced Hebrew at the time, and I would suspect that, you know, that, I mean, the Assyrian influence is a whole other thing. We discussed a little about that. Even though that happened on his coins, when he coined the coinage of, you know, the liberated Jerusalem, he put things in the archaic, in the paleo Hebrew, basically sort of saying, you know, let's get back to the great days of the past. And and similarly, if you look at not too far distant in space or time, if you look at the Dead Sea Scrolls, even though those were written in square Hebrew and very, very nicely done, even though that happened, whenever they came to the most sacred four-letter name of God in Hebrew, the one that you have to treat extra super specially different, so to speak. Just to make that clear for those who, you know, might not know this, there have always been ways that this name you treat in a special way, unlike other ways. And there have been different ways of doing it. And their way was to write that name in Paleo Hebrew every time they came to it. At least most of them did that. I don't know that all of them did, but some of them you write and it's this beautiful, beautiful, beautiful Hebrew calligraphy. And all in the middle of it, you see four letters in a quite different alphabet. By the way, talking about the square Hebrew, what is very interesting is something that I really should have looked up before this, you know, meeting. And I meant to, but I simply had no time.
Kate, maybe turn the camera back on yourself if we're talking.
I should do that if I can. Why do I do these things? And I know I should do it. How can I do it 1 minute? And I'm not, you know, losing my brain. They have
They have assured me of that, so bet it just takes me time.
Well, one of the things that's very interesting that was once pointed out to me by, of all people, a Catholic paleographer, calligrapher, who is now deceased. And she was actually a lettering artist, and she also was a school teacher. She had a lot of careers. Well, she was someone I knew very briefly, and I've read books by her. Someone you never heard of called Ade Bethune. One day, she actually pointed out to me once that if you look at the Catholic Bible, of all things, the Catholic version of the Old Testament, which basically has some books that did not make the cut into the Christian Old Testament or the Hebrew Tanakh, you know, Jewish scriptures, which are, you know, in other words, there are books that are old, that Catholics have, that they believe to be scripture and inspired, and that, you know, Jews and Protestants don't bother with. She pointed out to me, and I had meant to look it up before our meeting, but I was unable to. I just did not have the time because I had something come up at the last minute. I had to get out of the way. She pointed out that in one, that the Catholics, well, you know, in the Jewish scripture, we have the book of Ezra. They have a couple of extra books of Ezra called Esdras in their pronunciation. And one of those books, and I meant to look up the reference, but I didn't have it, has a scene in which, you know, Ezra, the scribe, in Babylonian exile, is sitting around, you know, writing down the Torah dictating it. And his five secretaries are hurrying like mad, you know, to keep up with the dictation, which, you know, as is portrayed in the story, is God dictating to him. But, you know, it could have been just him reciting while people were writing it down to make copies. And the way it's described is that as they were writing, in other words, they were writing very fast, and they saw their letters change into a new alphabet, and that became their new. Now, I would believe that what's being reported here is actually real, because if you have ever sat down and tried to take lots and lots of notes from someone who's speaking, and you want to get down every word, but the guy is a lot to go through, you know, think of some college professor you had, you know that as you write, your letters will start to change, usually for better or for worse, usually much for the worse. Angles will become rounded. Strokes will start to join together. Strokes that were upright may start to slant a little, and vice versa. And I believe that what possibly happened, this is just my own belief, and I could be really wrong here, but what I believe is that this is sort of a memory of people passing on, you know, the traditions, dictating to the next generation who was writing it all down for future reference, which would be important now that they were away from the place that had been their homeland. And then as you're scribbling to write things down, you end up looking for shortcuts. In other words, look at that samech. That would be exactly when you would start to say, I am not going to do three horizontals and a vertical. I'm going to scribble this thing down. Let whatever happen, happens.
But it's not going to happen all in one day.
It won't happen overnight. But of course, remember that in descriptions, in literary descriptions of past events, when we tell stories, often we condense things that happened over generations or millennia into a shorter time span. We often do that. And I am by no means a Catholic. I would, you know, I'm not going to quote the Catholic Bible as an authority on anything other than to say that it looks as if we have some kind of condensed description of what happened when you went from carving things into rocks with pointed chisels to, as we discussed a few months ago, writing things in soft, squishy clay, and which is a little harder to manipulate. And we do know, actually, as I also pointed out then, that the Assyrians were beginning to noodle around with, you know, ink on paper-like surfaces, and even on not-so-paper-like surfaces. Mm-hmm. And something that you chisel into rocks, if you're trying to do it fast, and what you're writing with is no longer a pointy piece of rock or metal being driven into another piece of rock or metal, you're going to have a smoother stroke. You're going to want to do different things. Your hand is going to want to move more from one letter to the other. And if we're talking Hebrew, that goes right to left, and you have a letter, you start at the top, you end up at the bottom, you're going to want to move to the left. And you're not really making a join, but you're almost making a join. Now, this is where I would like to go back to the back, you know, to the back camera to show you. A lot of people have wondered, and I don't know if everyone ever gets to learn, but a lot of people who know Hebrew, whether from academic study or growing up in Israel, as Julia did, you know, we know that if you know Hebrew, you know that certain letters have different ways that you have to write them when they are at the end of a word. Okay, for instance, I'm going to write them for comparison. For instance, this is, I'm going to go with the printed form just because that shows that doesn't exactly show how this distinction originated, but it's clearer to see it in the printed form than in the cursive form, which of course I could put up with. So this is an M, stands for M, but at the end of the word, it has to be like this. I might should have been the same size, but you get the picture. This is a Nun, stands for N. At the end of a word, it has to be like this. And now we have, let's see, I skipped one actually. I skipped a Kaf, and this is a Kaf, which is sort of a K or K sound, depending on the word. But at the end of a word, it's like this. This is, now let's see, I've left out a couple. Now this is a P, now P or F sound, depending, you know.
We can't see that.
This one here you can see a little better. Okay. But at the end of a word, it goes down. And this is a tsadi, which is a ts kind of sound. Let's make this. And this is how it is. But at the end of a word, it's like this. I will say my printed Hebrew is a lot better than my cursive, although at least I passed cursive Hebrew. Now, it's interesting. So we have these five things that change. Some languages have, you know, more in their scripts. Arabic has a lot of things that change. It has things that change in the middle, but we're just talking about Hebrew. Now, leaving aside the M for a moment, four of these five change by making themselves longer. And what the interesting thing is that the longer shape appears to have been the original and appears to have been the shape that came from Paleo Hebrew. And I'm going to leave out the mem until later. That's sort of a special case. For instance, let's move this down. We have our ka and our kaf. This is the final kaf, but what was this letter when it was in Paleo Hebrew? It was like this, the origin of our K letter we have in, you know, in our languages, in our scripts rather. And if you look at this, it's easy to see this became this. And then it's that became this. In other words, if you're writing a copy and there's another letter after it, once you know that there's such a thing as writing faster than chiseling into rock, your hand's going to move. You're going to sort of, you know, start to move up as you go into the next word. Same thing happened with, well, let's go to Nun, for instance. This is our ordinary Nun. This is the end of a word, the final one. But what was the Paleo Hebrew in one variation? It was this. It's obvious you went from this to this, and then you went to this, start trying to go to the next letter, going, of course, right to left. You are tempted to sort of go ahead. And so they didn't end up with joins, but they ended up sort of close to joins. I mean, to this day, you still don't normally join in Hebrew cursive. If you do, it's a mistake. I mean, you probably get the point. Same thing for the pay. And the evidence is that they did it in two strokes, actually. You know, and that this was the last one, and that the right side was the last one. Again, you swung up. Now, if you look at a lot of these,
I can't see the thing to the
move it right down.
Okay.
Now if you look at a lot of the Paleo Hebrew pays, that varied a lot, but some of them are a lot like this, and you can see the resemblance. Now with the tzaddik, which is
which I remember as being the hardest letter for me to learn to write when I was about 5 or 6. It just had angles in places that my American trained eye didn't expect angles, you know. I really knew how to, you know, read English when I started school. If you look at this tzaddik and this one, the Paleo-Hebrew one was a lot more like this, and often, in fact, longer. And you can see, in other words, this one gave us this one, which gave us this one. Now, mem is a different case. Mem did not originate from this simple, oh, let's be lazy and keep our pen on the paper as we go to the next letter kind of thing, which is where joins and many other things originate. What was our mem? I'm trying to get a little better handle on paper. You had your Paleolithic mem, which was something like this. Those of you who know Greek will recognize even something close to a lowercase Greek me, but that's another thing, you know, Greek is Greek to me, leave that aside. Once you had this, actually what happened, well, you did have one version where you have this, and you did have a version where you had something like this starting low down, and the temptation was to close it. I will need a new piece of paper. You have something like, if this is your, and we're actually not sure which way it was done. People argue about it. So it might have been done left to right. It might have been done right to left. What a lot of people think, and I think they're on the money, is that this letter did start left to right, and you did this sort of thing. And then when you wanted to aim to the next letter, you did this. And as a result of this rather wonky little shape, that shape at one point diverged in two directions. At one point, this actually is known not to have been regular at mem versus final mem. In the earliest days of the square script, you see that some people always wrote their mem like this, and some people always wrote their mem like this. And at some point, some of the older mems, in fact, are really, really long, as if someone is trying to replicate that long tail of the original. They might have thought, you know, it should have been there. They might have seen it. They might have thought maybe it's supposed to be there. Now, once you have two variants of a letter form, and if you have them in an alphabet where there are four other letter forms that change shape depending on whether they're at the end of a word, you're likely to decide, oh yeah, if those are different because one is at the end of a word, maybe that has to be true for this one. And of course, if you're going to decide which one is at the end, is going to be at the end of the word, and which one is going to be the normal one, well, you've noticed that all the ones that all the others that are at the end of the word, you know, have this sort of, you know, rectangular thing coming down. Kaf at the end of the word has this. Let's move us up here, right? And what else at the end? And nun at the end of the word has this. And, you know, sadi at the end of the word has this. And I left out pay out of order and pay at the end of the word. So you decide, oh, well, they all have this rectangle. So the one with the rectangle has to be the one we're meant to do as the final form. And that's really where it came from. Actually, and we don't just guess this because we actually find the transitional forms, just as biologists who study how various animals develop, you know, find the transitional forms, you know, between a wolf and a dog, or, you know, or some of the other changes that, you know, that we know occurred. And now, have you ever wondered about a really weird thing? Have you ever wondered why, of all the printed Hebrew, you know, we're talking about the formal square printed Hebrew, the only one with an actual ascender is the lamed? Have you ever wondered, like, you know, why does that get it? And all the other letters, they might have descenders. They might go down, but they don't go up. Ever wonder how that happened?
I don't know. It's a picture of a whip.
But leaving aside the fact that it was considered as a whip or a goad, that you can sort of see the stylized, you know, thing to beat up your animal with, you know. Even before that, we know that we had a lamed, and there were different versions. This, you know, we have this was one.
However, more of them were sort of angular, and you can see where our L came from. Well, one of these angular versions survived long enough. At one point, it wasn't that the llama had an ascender. It was that was about all it had. At one point, briefly, it actually looked like some version of what we would recognize as an L. But what happened was it was not really, but where it was written, it did not fit in visually. If you put it in the line with other letters, you could see if I write just some letters in the middle of the alphabet, you know, clum, nothing. Okay, kaf, lamed, vav, mem. It doesn't really fit. It's like a weird thing. So what happened was the people who had retained that form, they start saying, well, how do we make it fit in? Well, it has this horizontal, and Hebrew is full of horizontals on the top of the letter. So we will do this. And literally, at one point, you even see this in some of the Dead Sea Scrolls. It looks like the guy forgot to finish the letter, when actually that's what it was. It actually was a letter with nothing on the baseline, just as, you know, Yod has nothing on the baseline. But at some point, that started to look weird. You know, almost everything else goes down. This ought to go down too. It literally was not because of how it looked, but, you know, it literally was not because of what it meant, but literally because of how it looked and how it felt. Okay?
Another thing that you might notice is with the Paleo-Hebrew, the letters are facing, like they're facing to the left because they're going to go from right to left.
Well, correct.
And the Latin or the Greek versions are going exactly the opposite.
Well, because they were reversing. Now, what's interesting, and there's a lot to that, and they're more than most people know. If you want to know how they were invented to be so many of them with their details facing to the left. Well, think of how a right-handed person, and most people are right-handed, draws a picture. If I ask you to draw a side profile of a person facing one way or the other, or a horse or something, a right-handed person, if you've noticed, will typically draw it with the facial features facing to the facial features facing to the left. In other words, if you go and I ask you, draw a face, but not looking straight at you, looking to one side. Okay, and I'm going to scribble, you know, obviously with my right hand. Your main impulse is, you know, if you're not thinking, you're going to do, you know, very crude face here. This very, very crude face.
Well, I mean, if you look at the lish, if you look at the paleo lish, it's facing to the left, but the row.
Exactly, and that is.
But. Yeah. The Greek borrowing of it.
Yeah, but
the opposite way.
Yeah, but why did that happen given that they were also right-handed? Well, how it happened is, so you have pictorial symbols originally coming from pictures facing to the left. Then you have the Greeks borrowing them. Now, the earliest Greeks were also writing right to left, like the Phoenician teachers. And at that time, their letters also, their ancient Greek letters. And again, I do not really know Greek, but, you know, beta, let me get you a beta here. They would write, if they wrote a beta, it would be facing to the left. Like a B, which is why I picked that one. And you see on the very earliest Greek pottery, to the eyes of a modern Greek, the names all look to be written backwards. Then, well, something odd happened. As they were writing, they had learned to write right to left. At some point, they decided that they could really speed up. They said, you know, what we're writing right to left, end of line, right to left, and it takes a lot of time. And it's sort of hard if you're right-handed, you know, to go back, right to left, and go back, and go back. They decided, okay, we're going to write, and we're going to go right to left when we start, but we're going to go left to right on the next line. And meaning as the ox plows, you know, you have your ox plow, and, you know, you get to one end of the row and you turn it around to start. And of course, since they turned it around, the letters turned around. In other words, they conceptualized, let's see, the beta, as not so much. The pointy, sticky out things are pointing to the left, but the pointy, sticky out things are pointing in the direction you're going. And eventually they did give up on the whole left to right to left to right to left to right thing and just went, you know, left to right from right off. Now, what's interesting is this. There has actually been in modern times some brain research showing that when you are writing, your hemispheres actually function slightly differently in relation to each other, your brain hemispheres, depending on whether you're going right to left or left to right. If you are going right to left, they're actually, it actually is a little harder for the information to get from, to be integrated between the language hemisphere and, you know, the other hemisphere of your brain. Not that it's impossible, but it's a slightly longer trip. I mean, that sounds like sort of pseudoscience, but that is one of the very few brain hemispheres and writing things that have been found. I'd love to discuss it in another episode because there are more things like this. In other words, if you are writing left to right, at least for a right-handed person, it's different if you're lefty, you're ambidextrous, or sort of mixed up. If you're writing left to right, you do have a little more fluency. Now, people have claimed that you have different amounts of fluency from different types of writing, like print and cursive, but the research does not show that to be true. And there is some research, not a lot, but one or two bits of research that if you are executing symbols going left to right, and you are a typically organized mentally, you know, if your brain is the typical right-handed one, organized like that of most right-handed people, it will be like a little faster. And the Greeks were pretty smart cookies. Maybe they'd figure this out, I suspect, subconsciously. I would suspect that maybe if they were going both ways and it was just a drag doing it one way, because if you're right-handed, it's also harder to move your hand right to left, you know, I would suspect that they just said, well, you know, we'll just go and keep the other half of the equation. If the left to right lines, when you do them, are easier to write, well, you know, let's just write those. And I would suspect that this happened because there seem to be traces of it if you look at how capitals were formed apparently in Greek times and Roman times versus today, even though that's the same capitals. But I would like to save that. You know, it's 11:12. We've been here for an hour and a half. I don't see that many comments. You know, folks are probably losing patience with me. What do you think?
Well, turn around. I mean, turn the camera around.
I keep forgetting to do that, you know, but then again, when I do it, I keep wanting to, you know, I'm trying to.
We do have a comment by William, so I want you
William.
To.
I know several people named William, and I wonder if it's one of them. I don't see William's comment. It was the William Mankit. I do not know of any evidence that the Arabs created the cuneiform because in the region where the cuneiform originated, at the time, there were not yet any Arabs in that region, although there are many there now. In fact, the earliest cuneiform that we have appears to be at least 1,000 or 1,500 years before the speakers of Arabic or of any Semitic language moved into the area. So although it's perfectly true that people who are in what are now very Arab countries created cuneiform, the people there were not, as far as we know. In fact, the Arabs did not even begin to enter that area in their drive to expansion under, for instance, Muhammad, whom you doubtless know of, until after the last person to write cuneiform had died, because the last person to write cuneiform actually is known to have died about 1900 years ago. He was the last person who knew the system. He lived on the fringes of the Roman Empire, and apparently he was the last one because he couldn't find anyone else interested in learning it because no one was using it. Now, that was the last person to write it, and he died long before there were any Arabs in that part of the world. So if you have any sources that can demonstrate otherwise, if you have any solid archaeological evidence of Arabs in what is now Iraq and Iran and so on, all those many years before we thought that there were any Arabs there, I'm not going to say you're wrong, because we all know that history can be overturned in a minute when someone finds something new. That's what this whole evening has been about. But if you have found something new, or you know someone who can prove it, and I don't just mean someone saying, well, you know, I was taught this by, you know, someone I trusted, but if did someone actually find the rocks, the documents, the whatever it was, if you can find that, come back, and who knows, maybe Aya will let you do an evening sometime. But I think that Aya has even tougher standards than I do. And I think that Aya would want to see, now this went purple because I have my lights on a timer. I don't like to look purple. It's my reminder that I usually ignore that I should get ready to go to sleep, but I'm not quite ready to go to sleep. So Alexa, work lights. Yes. Wait. Yes, I'm one of those people who have a robot in their house. I mean, my robot doesn't move around, and she's, you know, she's about the size of an old-fashioned clock radio, but she does the job.
Okay, well, that's wonderful. You are
any other anyway,
in but the I, modern.
I would be very, if William Mankin has anything interesting to any websites, I will tell you that just because I don't think he's right doesn't mean I'm not going to read his website.
I don't think he has one. He shows up on my channel a lot. Yeah.
Oh, interesting. So. Well, if he wants to show up more, you know, I will be interesting. Let's just say that I'm sure that what he says is interesting. I'm sure that each of us would have many equally interesting questions. Any other comments or anything you want to go into?
Well, no, I found this very interesting. I really enjoyed your presentation, Kate.
Thank you.
I learned a lot. And so what is our topic going to be next
month? Well, let's see. Well, what we were going to do before all this archaeology stuff hit the news waves was Renaissance writing. And I would like to call that one Renaissance and Go for Baroque, because I would like to talk about how Renaissance handwriting did change gradually into what eventually became, you know, the cursive that we know and some of us love, most of us hate today. In fact, I might be able to digress a little into the fact that the Renaissance and Baroque period, as you'll see, was interesting because, believe it or not, we had not only see the first ever book on textbook on handwriting in our Western civilization published in 1522, but exactly 100 years later, in 1622, by the time the style had changed somewhat, we actually see the first ever textbook that was published on handwriting analysis. Now, I know some people who believe in it a lot, and I know some people who don't believe in it, and I have had some very interesting arguments with some handwriting analysts, you know, and since the roots of it are actually in the time when Renaissance and its handwriting began to go for Baroque, that actually is intertwined with some of the attitudes that some people in the handwriting analysis profession, you know, have today. And just to give you a little teaser, I don't want to give the name of the handwriting analyst I had in mind because, you know, let's say she ended up not liking me, and she's a professional, but she's a very sweet lady, and I don't want to hurt her feelings. Well, what was interesting was that she and I have been in some talks, and I actually paid her to analyze my handwriting because I get wildly disparate results when people analyze my handwriting. She said that she couldn't analyze it all because handwriting that is based on Italic, which she has heard a little bit about Italic, well, they're taught as graphologists that it's not individual and it cannot be. So even though I had paid her for full in-depth analysis, she said, I can only do the superficial one because I just know, you know, I know recognizing you're an Italic writer, I don't think you can be an individual, which, oh my God. Well, she actually did write the analysis, but I haven't seen it. She's mailing, but she actually refunded my entire fee. So I do want to thank, so even though I will not be naming her, I want to say at least there's one reasonably honest person in her profession, and we can discuss this. Again, I'm not going to reveal her name because she wants me out of her life, and I don't want to look as if I'm picking pot shots on someone. But since attitudes I saw from her were typical of the profession, I will basically at some point present a composite picture of graphologists I've known and why there's a war between graphology and calligraphy. So that will all be next month when the Renaissance goes for Baroque.
Okay, very good. I look forward to that. And thank you for your presentation tonight.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Good night.